My purpose is to praise you. My longing is to worship you. My life desires to live for you. I worship you for the mighty things you do. I worship you, 'cause in spite of all my misery and all the things I cannot see, I know I can call out your name. My purpose is to praise you. My longing is to worship you. My life desires to live for you. I praise your name, 'cause the victory is mine. Your blessings will be always mine. That's why I live, Lord, for you. For always and forever. My purpose is to praise you. My longing is to worship you. My life desires to live for you.
Hey man, can y'all hear me now? Hey man, we want to welcome everybody once again to the Reclamation Project with the conference. Amen. We want to thank everybody for coming out. I hope you guys enjoyed yourself. We have enjoyed you. We've enjoyed this conference. And before we begin, let's start off with a word of prayer. Let's all bow our heads. Father, in the name of Jesus, Lord, we just want to thank you once again, Lord, for everything you've done for us, Lord. Bless especially this evening, because this evening is your Sabbath. And Father, when it starts off with your Sabbath, Lord, it's a special day, Lord. So be with the speaker of the hour, Lord, but most of all, be with us. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. I don't know about you, but we had fun this week here with Reclaiming Your Purpose Week of Prayer. I hope you enjoyed the speakers. We have many more coming on this weekend. We have people who are millionaires and everything like that. Why? Because we want to make sure people are better with their health and their wealth. We got people with mental health. We got people who can encourage you with your jobs, what you're trying to grow a business, whatever God has for you. We want to make sure that purpose is instilled in you. So don't miss this weekend. We got workshops. We got great speakers. And I'm telling you right now, you don't want to miss it. Even got a special treat. We brought in Ice Cube's cousin. Yes, I said it. Ice Cube's cousin. Bring your secular friends too. Amen. So like I said, yeah, amen. Yes, I said it. They're going to come here and worship with us and also teach us some things. You'll be surprised who it is. Amen. I'll give you a surprise. I won't tell you who it is. But anyway, I want to remind everybody that tomorrow when we have worship service, we're going to be having Sabbath school. Amen. Nobody excited about Sabbath school starting at 9:00. Come on now. Hopefully you have some fun and you will enjoy, but most of all, you will learn. And I'll be teaching Sabbath school. So hopefully we can interact with each other, learn from each other. And we'll probably throw in some special guests there from time to time. So it'll be at from 9 o'clock to 10:30. And then we will start our Sabbath service. And then from 2 to 4, which is the workshop, will start on Sabbath. And we'll also be on Sunday from 2 to 4. And you definitely don't want to miss those 2 days. Bring your friends out. And I hope you all enjoy each other. And at this time, I am going to show you something. Y'all know what this is. For those of you who haven't shown, here we go.
It's really all about me. Never giving up, not quitting. Trust the process, I can trust my coach. So change starts with you. Everything that you need, the universe will open up and conspire with you when you have in your mindset that you're not a chicken, you're an eagle.
Amen. And now we will turn this over to Pastor Melvin Hayden.
Amen. Happy Sabbath, everybody. And I know you look like you want to say something. I don't know. It just feels like I muted everybody. Maybe it's a little too quiet. So I'm going to have you guys unmute yourselves right now. And just, I want to tell you happy Sabbath. It's good to see you. And if you want to say hi, if you want to say praise the Lord, why don't you go ahead and do that right now? If you want to greet somebody you see on the line, if you have a video screen, you want to open your video screen and just say, hey, I'm here. We are here to worship today. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Happy Sabbath.
Happy Sabbath, everyone. Good to be here.
Yes,
happy Sabbath.
Happy Sabbath. The heart.
How you doing?
Wayne Best.
Everyone.
Hey,
folks, America. Happy Sabbath.
Happy Sabbath.
Sabbath.
Hey, Dion, how are you? Elder Brian Brown, God bless you. And Kelly Robinson, there you are. Amen. Good to
Hi,
see
happy
you.
Happy Sabbath, everybody. Good to see you, everyone.
Happy Sabbath. Hey,
the Blakeney is here. Arnold and his family, A3 is here. Praise the Lord. Amen. Amen. I just want you to give a shout out. Let everything that hath breath praise the Lord. But it's hard to hear the praises if everybody's muted.
Praise the Lord.
So praise I just want to give you a chance to praise God. We made it through. Amen. This week of prayer has been amazing. It's been life-changing. And I don't know if you all recognize this, but none of our preachers are professional pastors. But they are definitely servants of the Most High God.
Amen.
And God has used them to speak, to preach. And it's been like therapy to me. I don't know about you all, but I've learned some things. We've had some therapists on. We're going to have a lawyer preach tomorrow. You know, God can use anyone in any line of work who's connected to him and is willing to share their testimony and share the word of God. Yeah. So, a tremendous week so far, and I'm very glad that you all are here and looking forward to tonight. Todd's wife is going to be preaching, and I'm looking forward to tomorrow as well. And please don't forget about the afternoon workshops. They're bringing in a variety of different individuals who will be blessing and sharing, giving us the tools that we need to know how to improve, whether it's emotionally, whether it's financially, whether it's with relationships, or just how to attain your own personal goals. I think that's what the sustained change is really all about. But I'll let Todd tell you more about that later. And I think we're going to go ahead and sing at this time. Is that right? If I'm remembering the flow of the program, we will have our opening song. And then I've asked for Elder Jesse Best is going to be praying for us tonight. Sit back and relax and give Jesus a chance.
Let us bow our heads and we look to God in prayer. Father God, Lord, we thank you for being such a wonderful and gracious God that you are. We thank you for your grace and mercy and your kindness and your protection that you gave us throughout this week. And as we come down to the Sabbath day, as we welcome into the Sabbath, we ask that you continue to bless us and uplift our spirits and uplift our burdens that have been burdened by some of us. Father, we know that 72 million people are upset, 78 million people are happy and rejoicing. The devil has this world in a turmoil, but he knows his time is short. He has people going against each other, family against families, friends against friends, all over election. But we as Christians know that you put in a king, you put kings, you put people in power that stand for a purpose and for a reason. We just have to pray that we remain faithful and true to your word, that we be a witness for those that are suffering and a witness for those that are going through. Father, many of your sons and daughters are crying out pain, and many are suffering from situations that they don't seem to have an answer to. But we thankful that there's a God who sits on the throne that still answers prayers and know our wants and know our needs. So we ask in the name of Jesus that you uplift those that are burdened. Remove the chain of bondage that the devil have over us, that that we feel that we can't come to you because of our sins. So we ask that you forgive of our sins, knowing and unknowing. Have us be the Christian men and women that you want us to be. Father, we know that this world is coming to the last days, and we must do everything in our power to save those that are searching. We pray for the ones that have left the church. We pray that they return back soon. We pray for our loved ones that are going through. We pray for marriages that are going through. We ask in the name of Jesus that you have us be what we need to be in the last days, that we be soldiers for you and stand on the battlefield. Father, we pray for each and every one that's under the sound of my voice, that you bless their family, bless their finances, bless their whatever their hands find to do, that you make a blessing out of it. Father, we pray for our pastors, our churches, our officers, our members, our conferences, our unions, and our worldwide churches. We pray for our brothers and sisters that can't worship the way they want to worship because of communism and other things that's keeping them from worshiping you. But we thank you that we still had the opportunity to worship you, Father. We pray for the speaker of the hour, that you let your Holy Spirit lead them and speak what need to be heard. Father, we all sinners, but we all saved by grace. There's no one perfect or better than the other. We all have to come to you in a time of need. We come to you for our blessings. So, Father, we thank you for sending your Son to die on the cross for our sin. And, Father, we pray that this Sabbath, that we close our eyes tonight, that we have a good night rest, and that you wake us up to see another day tomorrow, where we have a joyous Sabbath school, a joyous 11 o'clock hour. And we will all say that it's good to have been in the presence of one who can save and the one that can redeem. Even though we may not be in a church, but we thank you for the technology that we had, that we still see each other and worship with each other. So, Father, we pray that anything we've got to pray for, that would suffice in all our prayers and all our saying. Keep us safe. In the name of Jesus, I pray. Amen.
Got so happy, started to talk, saints. I am so happy for tonight. In fact, this is one of my favorite sermons that the speaker's about ready to preach. I was so happy when they're going to preach this one. It has always touched my heart, and I know it's going to touch yours. And not that because I know this one personally, but I've seen the growth spiritually that this person right now, I'm so proud to introduce. She's my wife. Some people say that, she can really preach. I'm not just saying that because I'm her husband. But anyway, I hope you enjoy her tonight. And here's a little bit about my wife. So did you know about her? Amen.
Swehla earned her Bachelor's of Music with a concentration in voice from Oakwood University in Huntsville, Alabama. She continued her education by earning her Master's of Music Education and K-12 teaching certification at the University of Nebraska at Omaha. Swehla has performed for a number of diverse audiences, including Bobby Jones Gospel, before Presidents Clinton and Bush, mayors like Lipke in South Bend, Indiana, and Fahey in Omaha, Nebraska, the Premier of Bermuda, and governors of Johannes, Nebraska, and Keating, Oklahoma. She has performed as a guest soloist for the Omaha Symphony and the Voices of Omaha and opened for Yolanda Adams, Vanessa Williams, Witness, and Ricky Dillard, and much others. She has served in a capacity as director of various choirs, some of which include the Mutual of Omaha Insurance Company's Gospel Choir in Nebraska, the University of Nebraska Gospel Choir, guest director and accompanist for the Show Choir Camps of America at Millikan University, and for the Music Experience 300 Voice Choir in Barbados. Some of her compositions include the capping song for the Nursing Department of Metro Community College and the American Medley, which she performed. For President Bush, she also composed and arranged songs on her two CD projects, Unique God of 1998 and her most current, Satisfied. Swehla has also done some songwriting for Gospel Incorporated in Nashville, Tennessee. When she is not performing, directing, composing, or doing workshops in and out of the country, Swehla enjoys teaching music for Portsmouth Public Schools, teaching private piano lessons for the community, and serving as Minister of Music for Campostella Heights Seventh-day Adventist Church. And she's a great coach. Great life coach, has a certification in it. But most of all, what she's proud of is that she's been married for over 20 years to Todd Hunt. You will hear in just a moment the wonderful voice of Swehla Hunt.
Hey. Amen.
Day by day, in every way, I'm getting better, better, better.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We want to be led to God's bleeding side. That is my prayer every day. That is beautiful that we kind of switched and my husband chose the song for tonight. That's my favorite hymn. Draw me near, nearer to God. Our theme text is, it is God who works in me because to will and to do his good pleasure. Philippians 2:13. I'm going to start with a little story and then we're going to have prayer. A young man wanted to go to the warehouse club. This place was the hype of the day. His father reminded him that he had to preach for the Thanksgiving service, and that he should stay home and prepare his mind, his heart, and his soul for that moment. But the son told the dad, I'm grown, and I'm going where I want to go. His father told him that as long as he was paying his Duke University bill, he wasn't going. But sadly to say, he snuck out and left. He got back home at 3 o'clock and showered and brushed his teeth and gargled and sprayed his clothes down and set his alarm clock, and he went to bed, and he was going to get himself ready after he had done all of that, what he did at the club. The next day, the young man and his father was driving to the Thanksgiving service, and his father, impressed by God, said, "Pull over, son." Dad questioned the son, and his son continually denied him. Dad reached over, though, and turned over the young man's hand, and a big W was on the back of his hand. For that was evidence where he had been. The title of this message is, Who's Working in You? Let us pray. Dear Lord, we just come before you right now, and we're asking you one more time to be with us, one more time to work in us, Father God. Lord, just be within me, talk through me. In Jesus' name, amen. We must understand that there are two people that can work in us, God and Satan. When Satan is working in us, we are parsimonious, we're stingy, we are ungenerous, we are pessimistic, we are gloomy, we're downbeat, we're prideful, we're self-centered, we're haughty, we're big-headed, we're condescending, we're overbearing, we're selfish. We feel as if we are the stuff. It's about how comfortable that we are in the situation. It's about what we know. We are self-driven instead of being God-driven. Unfortunately, the man's choice showed he and his dad who was really working in his life. And I come to tell you tonight that as the young man had a W on the back of his hand, we are walking around with G's or S's on all over us. People know who is leading us. People know who is working in us. And we can go around and act like maybe they really don't know, or try to fake it till we make it. But the world knows by our actions who we are working for. Our decisions stamp who is working in us. A lot of times we become so self-righteous that we feel like, oh, I'm fine. I'm gonna be in the kingdom. And that is what we want. That's where we want to go. But really, is our decisions lining up that choice? Are we really doing the things that will show the world and that will really show God who's working in us? Who's working in us will determine who we are connected to, who we are depending on, who we are living for. 1 Peter 5:8 says, be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, is walking around as a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. See, this enemy, this same enemy, this same cunning snake that was in the first night of this night that Elder Hunt preached. The enemy is so cunning and slick that he will set up situations for you in such a way that you choose them and you feel that you're doing things in the name of the Lord, when in actuality, you're doing it for self. You're doing it for vanity. My friends, if what we are doing in some way may help to rub our ego, then what we are doing is not through God. See, the young man in our story desired to do what he wanted to do. He depended on his talent of preaching to get him past his choice of going to the club. His mindset was on the feeling or experience of a good sermon. He knew he could preach. He knew he had it in him, but he had not focused on the transformation that God working in him and God showing him what to say could inspire for others. He was all about what he could do. He did not keep in mind that he was always set apart by God. See, when God is working in you, you understand that there is a choice. You understand that you were born for a purpose. These two people that can work in you, one is going to lead you to heaven and the other is going to lead you to hell. We have to look at will. Will is desire. It's wish. It's a choice. It's a determination. We have to look at do. Do is a perform. It's achieve. It's complete. We also have to look at the fact that when God is working in you, you understand who you belong to. You understand why you exist. You understand who needs you. When Satan is working in you, you are, as I said before, parsimonious. You are prideful. You are pessimistic. You have to keep in mind, though, that it's your choice. You understand who you belong to, who you need, and why you exist when you realize and you choose to understand and walk in God's purpose. My husband and I now a whole team, Sustain the Change team, realizes that you are created to live and not to exist. So many of us are walking around just existing. And for many years, I found myself walking around just existing, going day to day, doing my teaching, doing this, doing that. And I felt myself just existing. But after so many things that came about and experiences that happened in my life and losses and things of that sort, it was through loss that Sustain the Change came. It was after I had lost my last child, and I was laying in bed healing from the stillbirth. And I realized at that point, you know, children are beautiful and they're wonderful. And God has given me so many children in teaching. What really is God's calling for my life? What really does he need me to do? I know that the world has so many things and the world has a different method on what makes you successful. And I used to be so caught up in that. But I had to start thinking, God has a purpose for me. No, that wasn't my first time. But after I had been through two near-death experiences, it helped me to really focus on the fact that it's time to really just live for God. It's time to be focused on God. And so at that point, I made a choice. And I talked to my husband and I said, you know what? I want something different. I want to make a big difference for God. And at this moment right now, it's a choice. I'm choosing God. I'm not choosing anything else but God, because I learned that, you know, I said it for many years, but I realized it. God is really in control of what happens in my life. I can make so many plans, but God is the only one that's going to make whatever's supposed to happen, happen. Of course, if I choose him though. And we're going to keep talking about that. But at that point, I chose God. I chose to live by God. I chose to make decisions by God. My husband and I thought it was great. Yes, let's have kids. We have been saying that for years. We have been trying, and kids would come and go. And that was a point where I had to decide, folk, I'm getting personal with you. That was a part where I had to decide, is my desire to have children more important than what God needs me to do? See, we've got to think about this. Is what I want more important than what God wants for me? That's what this is about. Who is working in you? Who is driving your choices? Who is driving your desire? Who is driving your will to live? Who? So sustain the change was birthed. We realized that transformation in Christ is the secret to sustenance and achievement in life. We realize that the enemy's ploy of keeping us stuck in a place of fear and loneliness and rejection and anxiety and self-ambition and selfishness will keep you continually yearning for something better than eating. It will keep you in a mask. It will keep you not living out your truth. It will keep you not in living in authenticity. It will keep you from growing in Jesus. It will keep you always yearning for healing, but not really yearning for wholeness. See, God wants us to begin to sustain our change so that we can begin to live in freedom without the shackles of life holding us back. So again, the question I'm asking tonight, I want you to be honest with yourself. See, change comes first with honesty. We have to embrace who we are. We have to embrace who we want to be. We can't come into change lying to ourselves and feeling like we're somebody that we know we really aren't. And that was a come to Jesus moment for me, laying there being healed. I don't know why God brought that to me at that moment, but I do know that God always brings situations to save you. We think we're saved. We think we're ready. We think we're kingdom bound, and God will continue to put things in front of us to show us, get right with God. Those with the mentality of living know that they have a higher calling and are called by the Father. Those that have a mentality of just existing live their lives by change, doing what their fleshly desires want, staying in the moment, but not doing or reaching for the supernatural. They are determined to make themselves feel good. They exist in their jobs. They exist in their families. They exist in their life experiences, never really living in their calling or their purpose. They live for themselves. They do what makes them comfortable. They depend on what they know instead of who they could know, which is Christ Jesus. See, I've always loved Jesus. So don't get me wrong. Always loved Jesus. Jesus has always been my main squeeze. But God had to take me a little higher. Because I could not continue to fall in Satan's traps. I could not continue to be for God. And then sometimes, it had to be all or none. And I know I'm not the only one with this. I know that everybody on this call is fighting against this flesh, is fighting again in this war. But God is telling us in COVID that it's time to start lining our lives up with the right person. It's time for us to start exemplifying Christ. The disciples had this same problem. John 21:1-3. We're going to read that. It says, first of all, before we read it, it says, it's your choice. You are free to choose, but you are not free from the consequences of your choice. It's choice, not chance, that determines your destiny. Destiny is a matter of chance. It is a matter of choice. It is not a thing to be waited for. It is a thing to be achieved. John 21:1 says, there came together Simon Peter and Simon called, Didymus and Nathanael of Cana in Galilee, and the sons of Zebedee and two other disciples. John 21:2-3 says, Simon Peter, now I want you to listen to this. Simon Peter said unto them, I go fishing. Now we've read this several times, but God drops up mommy that I'm getting ready to bring to you. He said, I go fishing. They said unto him, we also go with thee. They went forth and entered into a ship immediately. And that night they caught nothing. I mean, nothing. Notice that they decided to go fishing. And they caught nothing. Did God ask them to go fishing? See, God has revealed to me that we are stuck in our situations because we decided to do the things that God never told us to do. We decided to marry that person. We decided to take that job. We decided to eat and drink what we wanted to, and then we were wondering why we're sick. We decided that career. We decided to go to that school. We decided that boyfriend. We decided because we're gonna decide. We decided to go in that direction, but yet we're all sitting here at the Sustain the Change Week of Prayer Conference wondering why we are still empty. Notice that they caught no fish. It is because of God's mercy that just like the disciples, we experience any achievement with this mindset because we have it too. But at this moment, Jesus was getting ready to show them the benefit of having God tell them to do things in life. They were getting ready to learn about the power of choosing to be led by Jesus, the power to obey Jesus, the power to surrender to Jesus, the power of being anointed by Jesus. Jesus wanted them to experience the effect of him working in them. Jesus wanted them to move from the levels of being experts to being anointed. from being experts to moving when and because of the call and timing of Jesus. All they knew was you go out, it's time to go fishing. We're going to utilize what we have and our expertise and our experience, and we're going to go fishing. But if you realize there are times when God, again, parks the car as the Father in our story earlier and says, it's time for you to change up what you're doing. It's time for you to go to the next level. It's time for you to experience something greater than what you know and then what you can provide. See, right before your breakthrough, you always have to make a choice. The man in John last night had to make a choice. He had to decide to get up. And I want to tell you all that I had two sermons for this week of prayer. And one of them was from the story that Joel preached last night. And it was amazing that God really wanted both of these stories, that he lined up a person that I had already gotten it ready. He had someone else do it. But God wanted us to know about who's working in us. The man and John had to make a choice to take a chance to get up with the knowledge and experience of not walking for 30 years and walk. We have been in our situations for too long and have sought after everything else but what God has for us. And we are now at our turning point. Our way has not been working, but God allowed the disciples' way not to work because God needed the disciples to realize that they had to choose to make a choice from their way to God's way. In this story, Jesus allowed them to choose when they were going fishing, but they still had to deal with the loss of catching no fish. See, God will allow us to decide what we want to decide, but we still are going to have to suffer and experience the consequences. My friend, Jesus has allowed all of us to choose to do things our way for so long, and he has positioned us right now to get up like this man and make a new choice. He is choosing for us right now. He's presenting it right now for us to choose the wonderful life that God has for us. And it may not seem wonderful down here on life, on earth, but with God, you have faith. With God, you have hope. With God, you have a brighter future. With God, you know that down here is not the end. You know that if you didn't get every promise down here, that you're going to get them all and much better in the kingdom. See, Proverbs 3:4-5 says, trust in the Lord with all thine heart. You know it, say it with me. And lean not to your own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge him, and he shall direct your paths. The second reality that Jesus needed the disciples to realize is that choice determines your destiny. Destiny is the events that will necessarily happen to a particular person or thing in the future. See, verse 6 says, cast the net on the right side and ye shall find. They cast therefore, and now they were not able to draw it. Come on now, for the multitude of the fishes. See, because they decided and they chose. Come on now. Come on, y'all need to get happy now. Because they decided to choose. Every time you decide to choose Jesus, you are going to get greater than what you started. Every time you choose to follow Jesus, his way, his gifts for you are going to be greater. Lining up yourself with God will line up a better future. You are lining yourself up for the kingdom when you choose God's way. When he is working in you, you will not care about your desires because you will know and believe that his way is the way to life. This is really Hebrews. Sorry about that. Hebrews 13, 20 through 21 says, now the God of peace that brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus, that great shepherd of the sheep through the blood of the everlasting covenant, make you perfect in every good work to do his will, working in you that which is well, pleasing in his sight through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. And friends, I want to tell you tonight that God wants to equip you. We don't have to keep trying to equip ourselves. God wants to equip you for doing his goodwill and doing things that please him. Sustain the change is about being equipped to do your calling. Sustain this change is about coming out of your brokenness and starting to live in freedom. But now is the time that you have to choose. Now is the time that you have to take off your mask. Now is the time that you have to be exposed. Now is the time that you have to get up and walk. Now is the time that you have to listen to God and his methods on how to get through this life. Now is the time that you have to depend upon God to hear his voice, to know who his divine appointments are for you. We're going to continue to stay in our mindset of really failure, really, if we do not begin to choose God. This sermon is simple. It's what God wanted. He even changed the original one because God wanted it so easy for us to understand. It's about choice. This whole weekend has been about choice. Choosing to decide which way you're going to go. Choosing to decide if you're going to stay in the mud or you're going to get out of the mud. Are you going to choose the alternative or not? Are you going to say, yes, I want to go to the kingdom? We say that every week. We do. But now is the choice to decide, I'm going to really go to heaven. So I'm going to deny myself and do what God is calling me to do. I'm going to surrender to his thoughts. I'm going to surrender to his mindset. That's what this is about. I'm going to surrender to his will. Psalms 37, 5 through 6, we read. Isaiah 48, 17 says, thus the Lord, thy Redeemer, the Holy One of Israel, I am the Lord thy God, which teaches thee to profit, which leadeth thee by the way that thou shouldest go. John 14, 6 says, Jesus said unto him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man can come to the Father but through me. So my question is tonight, do you want freedom? Do you want freedom? Story is told of a mother that had lived her whole life with asthma and sickle cell. She had had many close calls with these illnesses, but had always gotten through each challenge. She knew with her asthma that if she had her nebulizer or inhaler in her close proximity, she would be fine. She knew that as long as she rested and stayed in the bed, her sicklings, pains in her legs would go away at some point. Well, this particular time, she was not getting better. She had gone to the doctor to get antibiotics for what she thought was a little cold, and she did not heal. She began to feel the asthma attack coming on. Then her pains were growing worse in her leg. She was having a sickle cell crisis. She could barely breathe. She could barely walk. Her husband took her to the ER, but to her surprise, she sat for an hour gasping for breath and becoming more and more frightful and sick with pain. She went home and took a treatment, but she seemed to be getting worse. Then breathlessly, she told a few of her loved ones that she loved them, for she felt that she was going to die that night. But God, just like he raised Jesus out of the grave the next day, he raised her up out of her bed. She could not believe that she was still alive after nothing had worked. After she had tried all that she knew, but she at that point realized that she had to trust God and his process. She had to trust God's plan in stretching her faith. She had to trust in God's healing power that still gives her ammunition through her sickness today. She still is encouraged to let God work her life. For her life has been changed. She feels God's power all through her life, all that she does. The question is, though, do you want this power? Do you want God to change you? That's it, folks. It's time to choose the alternative today. It's time to choose Jesus. Some of you all say, I chose him a long time ago. I've been a Christian a long time ago, but God had this sermon preached for some reason. God needs us to rededicate again. God needs us to start over again and begin living as if he is really working in us. He wants others to be able to know and see and witness that God is working through you. So if God is working through you and they know everything that you've been through, then now they want God to work in them. That's what tonight is about. So I ask you now to put in the chat, I want to sustain. please put it in the chat. I want to sustain. I know it's longer than the word sustain, but in this life, you have to do things that may stretch you a little bit, some things that you don't want to do. Here's your first step. And if you don't do it in the chat, that doesn't mean that you're not making the step. But if you could, put, I want to sustain. I want to sustain this change. I want to start today allowing God to work through me. I want to surrender my all. Let's pray. Lord, dear Heavenly Father, we thank you. We thank you for this message. Father, you led it. You said it. I pray that you will help each individual here tonight that has heard this message. This message definitely didn't come from me, Father God. So I ask that they will hear it and they will take heed to what you need them to do. Father, I pray that you will help us to really strive daily and continually striving to be saved into your kingdom, Father God. Father, we have skeletons, we have masks, we are living these lives that only you know we need to clean up. So we're asking in your name, Jesus Christ, that we will not take this moment for granted. For tomorrow, for the next moment, Father, we know it's not promised. We ask that we will stop leading our lives and that we will allow you to lead our lives. We will not choose aimless decisions, but we will seek you in everything that we do. And I pray after this conference is over that we will still be fired up to do the calling that you have called us to do. Father, pull us out of depression, Father God. Pull us out of fear. Pull us out of rejection. Pull us out of selfishness, Father God. Pull us out of being self-driven, Lord. And drive us to your throne right now, Father God. My life has truly changed. And I pray that others too, their lives will be changed. And that they will be difference, make a difference in the lives of others, sharing the good news that it's not too late to start today. We thank you and we praise you for this moment. We thank you for Pastor and his opportunity that he has granted through you to allow us to minister, Father God. And we ask that at the end of this, we will all have freedom to live and be who you've called us to be. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Amen, Sister Hunt. We just want to thank her right now. Amen. Hope you all enjoy that, the sermon there. And I know I'm not Swehla Hunt right now, but I'm just going to ask right now. All right, I'm going to ask right now. First of all, did anybody bring 20 people tonight?
Or through the week?
Anybody. If you have, do we have anything, Pastor Hayden? Come on, talk to me. Anybody bring 20 people tonight? If you have, we got a special gift just for you. Amen. All right. We don't have crickets yet. Amen. That's all right. We're going to have faith. Amen. Now, this is going to be the first question I have tonight, and this is for this lovely shirt you can see right here. I believe somebody already got their shirt already this week, amen, to show the congregation, amen? Just wave your hand, you know who you are, amen. The first question is this, and put it out there in your chat. The theme text for tonight, can you give me that scripture? What was the theme text for tonight? Anybody? Who got it? Hello? Who's the theme text? Anybody know?
Let me unmute. You want them to raise their hand or should I unmute?
Put it in the chat. Put it in the chat so we have
okay.
Just put it in the chat. Yep. All right. Put sustain first and then put the text in there. Let me help you out. Somebody answered close, but not quite. It's Philippians.
Oh.
Philippians 2.
Come on, y'all. He's giving you the answer.
We'll give you the answer. If you want this shirt, this is yours. 13. The first person I put Philippians 2:13. This shirt is yours. Amen. Philippians 2:13. Put it in the chat right now. Put sustain and Philippians 2:13. Do we have anybody?
Boom, right there.
We have one?
Yep.
Amen.
It's from Elder David Tunis and family, but I don't know who's typing.
Whoever you are that's typing, please give the pastor your name and shirt size and address, and we will send the shirt to you. Amen. Now this next one right here, all right? This next one right here, because we want to give away some good gifts. Amen. It's good to give gifts, especially to the household of faith. Amen. Now, this was another question, all right? Found in John 21, 1 through 3, okay? This is what she said in her sermon, right? I want you to type in the chat, right? All right. I can't unmute myself, but Dion is typing. Amen. So type it in the chat, all right? Who was they that decided to go fishing? Who decided to go fishing? Put it in the chat right now. You get a gift certificate. Amen. Who were they that decided to go fishing? All right. This family's on fire. But you got to put sustain in front of it. Put sustain in front of it. Sustain and then the answer. Put sustain and then the answer. Right now in the chat. Yes. Amen. So we have two from the same family. We don't know who they are, but we're going to have you all figured out. You have won two gifts tonight. Amen. You won a shirt and you won a lovely gift certificate. And please give us your shirt size and please sport it at some point during the weekend for those who have won. Amen. So that way we can encourage other people. Well, saints, I'm glad that you all came out tonight. I'm glad that you had a little fun here. We're going to hand out more gifts for people. Please bring guests, especially tomorrow from 2 to 4. We don't want to miss that. And Sunday from 2 to 4, we want to give out gifts all weekend long because we believe in you. Amen. Sandra, okay, we got you. All right, so make sure we get that there, Pastor. And at this time, as we get ready to close, we want everyone to just bow their heads as we get ready to leave so we can get up in the morning. Let's all bow our heads tonight. Father, in the name of Jesus, Lord, we want to thank you, Lord, for that wonderful sermon, Lord. We want to learn how to trust you, Lord, and you alone, Lord. So, Lord, in the name of Jesus, Lord, heal us, Lord. Heal us of our infirmities, Lord. Heal us of our sickness, Lord. Heal us of our sin, Lord. Save us, Lord. Lord, because, Lord, all of this done and we don't make it into the kingdom is just a waste. So, Father, everybody here tonight, put a hedge around their home, Lord. Put a marking at their desk, Lord, so that, Lord, when you come again, we will be received in you, Lord. So, in the name of Jesus, bless, sustain the change. Bless the churches, Mount Calvary and First SDA Church, Lord. Bless the pastor, Lord. Bless our speaker for tomorrow, Lord. Irvin Daphnis, we pray. Amen. Now, folks, tomorrow you don't want to miss this dynamic preacher. I mean, he inspired me to serve the Lord way back when I'm in my 20s. His name is Irvin Daphnis Esquire. You don't want to miss. Please bring out their neck because I'm telling you, you don't want to miss this. He changed my life. Amen. Oh, praise the Lord. We even got.